Sweet. First off, what's the day? What's your day like on a normal Thursday for K1?
On a normal Thursday, I don't think there is a normal Thursday. Every Thursday is different.
Yeah.
This Thursday in particular, I'm back home in Masterton, so I'm chilling with fams. I was down here for the Homegrown Festival just last Saturday gone, so I decided to miss my flight and just head over to Masterton and spend the week with fans and get to see my kids and stuff. So it's back to Auckland tomorrow and back to work.
Awesome. How many kids do you have? Two daughters?
I have two daughters, yeah.
What's their names?
Dream and Summer Jade. And Dream is 8 and Summer Jade is 7. So they're at school right now, so I'm just chilling.
Nice, great. No daddy daycare?
Nah, no daddy daycare.
Awesome. Bro, so you've been rapping for a long time, I reckon. Like, I first heard you doing songs with Sam Tanner.
Yeah.
So from that to the deal, how did that come about?
So yeah, even in that sense, it wasn't even that long ago. Like, those songs with Sam were only, say, 3 years ago, but I did start a long time before that. I was working with some dudes that, my boys and friends from school and stuff like that. But in terms of coming to the deal was, I just shot my demo around Sam Tanner. He was the only guy that actually had recording gears and mastered them. So it was a blessing to run into him, and you know, he said, bro, I'll record you. So we put together an EP. The main purpose of that EP was to shop it around. I needed some music. I knew what I wanted to do. I knew that my main goal was to get signed, and I needed something to, you know, submit to the label. So we put down an EP. It was 4 tracks, and I just sent that to pretty much everyone I could. And you know, I got a few replies, and then I got the reply from Patriarch, Illegal Music, and it all pretty much went from there.
Yeah, I heard that you guys were back and forth trying to put together something to produce to the label.
Yeah, definitely. Of course, the demos that I was sending, you know, were pretty raw. They weren't the best, but he had the vision, and he saw that, you know, he could see something in my music, and he wanted to try and develop it first before presenting it to the rest of the team. So it was a bit of a secret at first. And then one day I got a call. I was actually at work in the middle of the bush. It was on a Tuesday, I remember it. And he said, I want to fly you to Auckland this weekend. And I was in the middle of nowhere. We were actually on a stay up. So I was 2 hours from the nearest town. I was 5 hours from home.
Is that doing forestry?
Yeah. So I pretty much just walked out. I rang up my missus. I told her to come pick me up from the middle of nowhere. And I pretty much walked out because, you know, I wasn't going to let that opportunity slide. So that was cool. I came up to went up to Auckland, and, you know, just spent the weekend there. We jumped in the studio, laid some stuff, and I got to experience a bit of the industry. They took me up to Warner to introduce me to all the peeps. We went to a couple of gigs and stuff like that, so I really got to have an inside look. And then when I came back to Masterton, it just wasn't the same, and so I just pretty much left my job and moved straight to Auckland.
Choice. So at what point, or are you feeling comfortable now, like now that you have the deal?
I think just as of late, this year, 2012, I am feeling quite comfortable. It's really good to actually feel just kind of established in the industry. Like, obviously, I haven't been here for a long time, but what I have done over a short period of time, you know, has made me feel quite comfortable. But it's also, it's made me more hungry as well. You know, I've thought that if I could do that in such a short time, then there's so much more that I can do from now. Being more established in the industry has given me a lot of time to, you know, it's allowed me to sit back a lot more. I think when I first moved out to Auckland and when I was first trying to make a name for myself, I was oversaturating myself. You know, I was trying to be seen at everything, you know, just trying to, I was jumping on everything. Well, you know, it worked in my favor in the end. I was on every track that Illegal put out. So that you know, that's obviously a strategy and a plan, and that worked. But now I can just kind of sit back, focus on my own music, and you know, just see what 2012 has in hold.
So we'll go back to your first release with Illegal, the mixtape.
Yeah.
What was the idea behind that?
The mixtape was sort of just for the street fans. You know, I didn't want to forget about, you know, the likes of the dudes that come on Ayebro and check out Ayebro. You know, I wanted something for them. Not everyone buys your music, you know. That's just a fact. But so it was good to have a free download and something a little different from what I was going to be releasing. You know, it allowed peeps to, you know, see a different side of me. You know, and it was really just an introduction and the whole thing. Welcome to the bright lights. It was just everything I was seeing since I'd come to Auckland and that, and Sex, I just ripped it, you know, he killed it. And so it was really cool to have that for the underground. You know, I had to pay dues because that's where I'd come from, so you can't forget about that.
For sure. So after that mixtape, or even beforehand, were you working on the albums? Like ideas?
I was on ideas, and then when it came to the time to record the album, when we got the, you know, we got the release date from Warner, and I erased everything. Like, I started from scratch, so the album is actually only recorded in 2 weeks. So everything I had been working on, I just binned it. Everyone's like, what'd you do that for? And there were some good tracks in there, but I just don't think that they reflected where I was at that time. You know, there was a lot of raw stuff, and even when I relayed it and stuff, I still wasn't feeling it. So I really just wanted to you know, show where I was at. And it was more just a reflection. I looked at the album as a reflection, and it was 2 weeks of kind of looking back over the last 18 months of what I had experienced and my journey.
Yeah. Was it hard to adapt to living in Auckland, coming from a small place like Masterton?
Definitely, bro. That was one of the biggest changes for me, especially coming from my job as well, forestry. And then going to the big lights in the city, and everything so fast. I was used to a slow life. I was in Masterton my whole life, so that was 23 years up before I moved to Auckland. So it was just a huge contrast. Everything was different. I had to settle in. You know, I had no boys up there. I was lucky enough to have fams there who took me in, and you know, all that. It was a bit of a struggle at first, but it all paid off.
Choice. So on the album, Far From Home, what was it like working with a legend like Shefu?
Oh, bro, that was sick. Like, that, he was one of the first names that when we talked about who I wanted to collab with, and it was Shefu, was one of the first names I said, because to be specific, is still my favorite NZ album. He was a huge idol. He still is a huge role model for me. I think the way that he holds himself and him as a person, I can relate to a lot. So, you know, I have a lot of time for Shay, and we catch up every now and then, and it was just so cool to have him on the album and to actually work with him in the studio as well. All the artists that are on the album, we actually work together in the studio. It's not just send the track and you know, you lay your verse and then send me the verse and I'll chuck it on. It's we brought them all to the studio and we spent the day working on the tracks and we laid together. So that was a cool experience as well.
Having the person in the studio compared to sending verses via email, but I can hear it.
Definitely a good example of that is the track We Ain't Gonna Stop with Ty and F. We all jumped in the studio that day. We all met up at the studio, and just the atmosphere that day was crazy. Like, you know, we were amped, and we were all vibing off each other. There was a bit of alcohol flying around, so it was cool, and we just amped each other up, we pumped each other up. And when I heard Ty's verse and I heard F's verse, you know, it made me want to better myself, because I heard these verses and I was like, you know, it's the big time now. You're dealing with the best, and you have to, you know, you can't be getting killed on your own song, sort of thing.
Because no doubt those two right there two of the best,
oh definitely,
you know, rappers, MCs in New Zealand. So you must bit of pressure there. Sure.
Yeah, there was a bit of pressure, and I'm not gonna lie, you know, I was nervous going to the studio that day, and then but you know, once we get together, and we're all friends as well, you know, we hang out, so that sort of thing was cool. But when you get into the studio, that sort of friends thing goes, and it's time to get to work, and you realize that, you know, these guys are the best at what they do. And it was cool just to work with them and also see how they work as well. You know, we all work differently, and so it was cool to see how other artists work and how they lay and how, you know, their studio ethic.
Yeah. another song that was on the album so long. Now there's a remix with Skype. How did that come about?
Cool. So Long. So Long was the original, was on the album. It was really unfortunate because I wanted to get Scribe on the album. You know, Scribbles was another name that came up first that I wanted to get on the album. We had talked about it. He was keen. When Warner gave me the date, you know, there was just the timing didn't work. He was off doing his thing, and we just couldn't get him in the studio. So I was a bit gutted about that. And so we were looking for somewhere that we could slot him on my music. And then when we got funding for So Long, and we thought, you know, how about we do a remix? And chuck Skribe on it, and you know, that all fell to place. Skribe heard the song, he loved the song, and we flew him up for the day, and we just jumped in and recorded that again. And I wasn't actually going to rewrite, and then I heard his verse, and I was like, oh man, I think I need to rewrite the first. So I just rewrote on the spot, and we made that track right then and there.
And then you guys went over to Aussie with Shea Sterling to shoot the video.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Bro, that's probably the highlight of my career, eh? Like, that was so mean. It was a whole new thing for me. Just traveling overseas to shoot a video was cool, just that fact alone. But and when we actually hit that Salt Lake, like, you know, I'd seen photos in that, but when I hit it, I was overwhelmed. Like, I was like, oh man, this is, you know, it was crazy that there's this thing in the middle. It was desert, like, and then all of a sudden there's this huge Salt Lake. And sort of the size we worked out was probably from about Hamilton, or, you know, that side of the Bombays to Whangarei. So that was the size of it. So, like, you were just looking into an infinity and just seeing the mirage on the horizon was crazy.
How long had you guys been planning that? Because that's a big deal to go over overseas, shoot a video, you know?
Because Shay actually approached us. He saw the funding. And, you know, the way that Shay works is, you know, he doesn't just take any video. He you know, he listened to the song, and then he hit us up and said, yo, you have to let me shoot that video. He'd been wanting to shoot on a Salt Lake for a long time. There's another couple around the world in Bolivia and Utah. But, you know, obviously with time constraints and funding and stuff like that, it wasn't possible to go there. But we found that one in Adelaide. And I was like, you know, he was like, oh, we can go and shoot it there. The planning before that was actually quite rushed. Like, we only sprung on him the week before the shoot that Skribe was going to be in it. So,
wow.
Yeah, it was all pretty last minute, and Skribe was actually in Perth at the time, and we had to try and get him to where we were, which was a mission. He flew, his flight was delayed to Adelaide, so he missed his connecting flight. We were going to have to drive like 8 hours back to Adelaide to pick him up, but we found another, like, it was just all last minute. We found this last minute flight that could hop on to a place called Waiala, and would only have to drive 3 hours to grab him. So it was all kind of last minute, but, you know, I was getting a bit worried there for a minute. I was like, damn, like, we're not actually going to get him in the video, but it would have been all good. We could have shot him back in New Zealand, but the whole thing of having us both on the Salt Lake was just primo.
What was the encounter with a kangaroo?
Actually hit one. So that was crazy. They just run out in front of you. Like, I don't know what's wrong with their brain. Like, they're not too onto it, and they see the car, and they're trying to hit you. I don't think they're trying to avoid you, but it looks like they're trying to hit you, and they just ran straight into the side of the four-wheel drive that we're in. Kind of got wedged up underneath the wheel and then spat out. And outback people had told us, if you hit a kangaroo, then keep driving, like, don't stop, because they can get pretty feisty. And so I was just going, go, go, go. And so then we chucked up that everyone hits me up, like, did you actually eat it? We chucked it up online that we actually ate it. But I'm going to tell the truth here. We actually went to the supermarket and we bought some roux kebabs, and we cooked those up and just pretended that it was the roux that we had.
What does a kangaroo even taste like?
It was buzzy. It was actually nice. but it was probably because we had Petrarch on two of us, and he's a chef. He was a chef for like 15 years or something.
Man, so, I've seen his pictures on Facebook.
He is the man. So we had him cooking it, so that's probably why it tasted so good. But it's actually like a mix of venison and beef. It was weird, but it was nice at the same time.
How was homegrown?
Oh, bro, homegrown was so mean. I love that festival, eh? Like, it's just cool to have a whole day dedicated to New Zealand music. And, you know, just seeing all the other artists there. The lineup in our tent was so mean. So it was cool just to hang out in there. After my performance, I'd had a few to drink, and I kind of just flagged the VIP and jumped into the crowd and just, you know, I had my boys from MA there, so we just started roaming around. So that was cool to be able to go and check out other New Zealand artists from other genres that I probably wouldn't usually go to see. And it was cool to actually go and see them do their thing, and it inspired me a bit, you know, seeing their live shows and stuff like that. You know, you can always add stuff to your sets and that. So it was cool to see everyone else in action and just catch up with obviously my peeps from back home, because there was a lot there, being at just over the hill in Wellington, and also just being with the people as well, like catching up. I met so many cool fans and stuff like that, and you know, they were buzzing out that I'm just rocking around in the crowd with my boys. But you know, that's just the way that I like it.
Yeah, hard. When you were watching the acts from different genres, did you get any ideas to collab?
Yeah, definitely. There's always like you always have dreams to collab with, especially I think on the when I went to look at the Dub and Roots stage, you know, and you see those guys perform, and they're such mean performers, the likes of Cora, you know, Fat Freddy's, and their vocals and that are so mean. So you know, if it ever came chance to, if there ever came an opportunity to do a song with one of those dudes, I'd definitely jump at it.
Awesome. Is there anyone in New Zealand that you haven't collabed with in the hip hop scene that you want to? That you can name?
I'm trying to think, because I've collabed with a lot from the. I haven't collabed with D-Dot, so you know, there's all, obviously we're probably on a different path at the moment. But he was a MC that I looked up to a lot. I remember when he came out on the Not Many remix. I remember his verse on that, and I was just thinking, man, this guy's crazy. Like, he is the man. So you know, I've kind of based it on that. Like, dudes that I used to. Yeah, idolize. I really want to work with, because it's such a surreal feeling to, you know, 10 years ago I was watching these dudes on TV, and you know, they were my idols, and well, they still are. You know, I still look up to them, but you know, it's cool to be able to actually have that chance to work with them.
Is there any up and coming MCs that you feel are on your toes? If you know what I mean, like you're watching them, like, you know, they have something special. Is there anyone that you have your eye on, or are you focused on your own music?
I listen to everything. I'm you know, I know that a lot of the underground dudes know that I do listen to everything, and I do show love. I can't name anyone in particular, but I'm just saying that, you know, the underground is in good state at the moment. I'm always on Ayebro, I'm always checking out stuff, and when dudes do send me music, I always check it out. Like, you know, I'm not that rude dude that just, you know, just ignores you. You know, I always check out the whatever they send me. You know, it's a, I knew that was a big buzz for me coming up. Like, you don't expect anything, but just the fact that they listen to it is a big buzz, and it's also inspirational to them. So, you know, if I can do the same thing that dudes were doing for me back then for these guys, then, you know, it's a pleasure.
Yeah. Do you have any advice for the upcoming MCs in New Zealand?
I think it's just get your music heard is the biggest thing. And that's, you know, things like Ayebro and that really help with that. I remember before Ayebro, there wasn't really anywhere to put your music up apart from Bieber and whatever was back then, MySpace or anything like that. But I think with all the blogs and stuff like that, it's cool that music is getting heard, and it's no point. I know these dudes, you know, that make music and then they're too shy to show it to anyone. So you know, that's cool if you're doing it for love, but I really just, you know, I think that show it, like get it out there. Like, what's the worst thing that could happen? I know that for myself, I was scared about what other people would think, and you know, I didn't take bad critique well. I used to nut out, like, you know, when someone would think, but I think you just have to take that with thing, you know, it's just one person's opinion. I think the biggest thing is to get heard, and also I think just learn a little bit about the industry before you come into it. I had no idea, and so I kind of got chucked on the deep end. Also, coming from Marcelin, a small town, dudes in Auckland are lucky. They're around it a lot. You know, they're around the industry. They know the industry. They, you know, they get to meet the industry people out, so they make friends and they get to see a little inside look. But I came from Marcelin, where there was no one doing that sort of thing. So I kind of got chucked on the deep end and didn't know what to expect. So I think it's cool if you do have a little bit of knowledge of the industry before you actually come into it.
What's on your playlist at the moment? How are you feeling? Around the world, local, whatever.
On my playlist, definitely Cole. I listen to a lot of J. Cole. I've been listening to a lot of Kendrick Lamar as well. Also, what else has dropped? The Weeknd. Love The Weeknd. I'm listening to him. Frank Ocean, huge Frank Ocean fan. A lot of people, when they hear what I listen to, they're buzzing out because it's nothing like my music that I make. You know, don't get me wrong, these guys probably don't influence my music too much, but you know, they're who I love to listen to. I don't think there's any artist that really influenced me too much music wise. I use them for inspiration, and you know, I love watching stuff like interviews and behind the scenes or in the studio, and that really inspires me. Whenever I've got like writer's block or something, I always watch like a documentary on someone, and it always gives me that inspiration and the ideas start flowing. So I don't think they really influence my music, but you know, they are huge inspiration, and that's just what I love to listen to.
I'm gonna put you on the spot. Okay.
All right.
Top five MCs ever. Your favorite. Not the best, you know.
Not the best, favorite. But favorite.
Your favorite.
Okay, top five artists. Oh, top five MCs, right?
Your favorite.
My favorite MCs. All right, so obviously Tupac, I was hugely influenced by the West Coast rap coming up. Nas, for storytelling, which, you know, I'm known for my storytelling as well, so I think that kind of inspired me as well. This one might throw people off. Jadakiss. I'm a huge Jadakiss fan. I always have been. Way back from the locks and all that sort of stuff. So I'm a huge Jadakiss fan. Probably have to put in a newbie. So J. Cole is obviously my favorite at the moment. I think he's gonna, you know, he's gonna eventuate into a great. And lastly, ah, man, this is hard. Kanye. Not just for his rapping and stuff, just for his whole artistry, his whole creativity, you know, all of that. So I have to be here.
You said on Good Morning that he's the one artist you'd want to work with.
Yeah, definitely. I think just because he can do it all as well as a cool.
You get the whole package deal with him.
Yeah. You don't have to involve anyone else. And just his music as of late is very cutting edge, and so I'm liking that sort of stuff. And but I also like the old Kanye as well when he first came out. So, but and also, you know, as a lyricist in that, he's actually quite talented, and his verses in that, he's also like Jigga. You do have to, you know, kind of read between the lines sometimes with their raps.
Choice. So we did the top five your favorite MCs. Can you do top five albums?
Top five albums. Yeah, I can. So obviously Illmatic be on there. Some of my faves. The Black Album from Jay-Z is actually one of
them. That is mean, eh?
Yeah.
A lot of people don't say that.
Yeah. So that's on there. Another, this is you know, it's obviously not one of the best albums of all time, but it's one of my favorites, and that's Regulate G-Funk Era from Warren G. I used to listen to that end to end, so that's one of my favorite albums of all time. Gotta chuck NZ in there, so Shefu, to be specific, the first one, that's gotta be a favorite. And my favorite album of all time is Miseducation of Lauryn Hill.
Nice.
Yeah.
Hey bro, how do you deal with the media attention that you're gaining?
I'm still getting used to it. It's still a buzzy feeling for me. Especially, I think it was last week I did the Good Morning Show, you know, doing stuff like that. it buzzes me out because, you know, you used to see and all these stuff, these programs that you used to see on TV and used to see your favorite artists getting interviewed on these TV, on these shows. And now it's you. So that's pretty buzzy for me. Lately, also the media attention has been picking up as well. But I think that just comes with the territory and you have to get used to it. Back in the day, I was shy as, you know, I used to, you know, cry before school speeches and stuff like that. I never used to like speaking in front of people. And so now my family and my friends from back then will buzz out when they see me on stage in front of thousands of people sort of thing. So that's cool as well. So I feel that I'm growing as a person as well as with my music, you know, as a person, I'm getting more outgoing and, you know, learning how to hold myself a bit better. And obviously the more interviews you do, the better you get. I remember my first interviews that I did do were terrible. You know, I'd sit there and nod my head to a couple of questions and they're like waiting for an answer. And I'm, you know, I had nothing. So I think it's cool to look back to that and then look now and see how you progress. And yeah, you know, the media attention comes with it. So it is something you have to deal with.
What's next for you, bro? Like in the near future?
In the near future, so this year, 2012, is all about trying to break into Australia. That's all I'm focusing on. We will be releasing my music soon over there. We've got distribution over there, so my music will be releasing soon over there, and I'm on Gold Coast next week for a gig. So it's just kind of, you know, getting the name out over there. It's kind of show and prove, so I've got to start all over again, go over there and be a no-name and try and make my way through there. And it's buzzy because I haven't even been in New Zealand for that long either. So you know, you just got to have the faith and I you know, believe, you know, that it can happen. I've been listening to a lot of Australian hip-hop and Australian the stuff that's in the charts over there, so it's been cool just studying and researching what kind of music that Australia gets into and how I'm going to fit into that over there.
Awesome. So when you first came on the scene via Illegal, those shows you were doing with Jay Williams must have been so beneficial, not only for the fan base, but also the experience. Can you speak on that?
Yeah. No, that's a big thing. That's a good question, bro. I owe a lot to that. You know, that was huge for me. Coming into the game, I see a lot of other artists that came in at the same time as me, and they, you know, it's a struggle to try and get gigs and stuff like that. But I was lucky enough to have Jay Williams on my team, who was, you know, he's the biggest, you know, pop sensation in New Zealand. So, you know, a pop and R&B sensation in New Zealand. So the gigs were coming freely. So he gave me the opportunity. You know, he was nice enough to let me on those sets. And, you know, he could have said, no, I don't want him on there. So, you know, he was cool enough. We became good friends, and he was cool enough, you know, just to let me on the sets, let me get, you know, have my little bit of shine every gig that we went to. And also I got to, you know, see a lot. I got to be involved with a lot that artists just coming into the game would not usually get to do. So that was hugely beneficial, bro. That I owe a lot to that.
Yeah. How's your relationship with the other label mate, Tyson Tyler? Like, he's a fierce MC. You guys vibe off each other, compete?
Yeah. Now, I wouldn't say compete, because we're going for a different demographic sort of thing. The cool thing with Ty is he's so raw, and, you know, and he is a fierce MC. And I remember when he first came to the, when Patriarch first told me, he was like, yo, we're thinking of working with Tyson Tyler. And I said, bro, hard, like, he is the man. And I was a big fan, so it was cool to have him come to the team. And just also having him around is, you know, he's the life of the party whenever he's around. So it's cool when he comes on shows and on tours, and we chat, and, you know, we both have a mutual respect for each other, which helps, you know. He respects what I do, and I respect what he does, so it's really cool.
Can you give us a quick rundown of the Illegal team in full? Because a lot of people don't know who's involved with Illegal, you know, the background as well.
Yeah. So you obviously got Petra, who's the founder, and then also his business partner, Hard Work. So Hard Work and Petra both run Illegal together. Then there's 6L, who's our DJ. A lot of people think that 6L owns Illegal, because 6L tells me that he gets a lot of demos and stuff like that. So that cracks me up. But he's actually, he's our DJ. And obviously, you know, a member of Ill Semantics, and that's how him and Patriot knew each other. And then... and it's pretty much that Patriarch and Hard Work are the management team. You know, they're pretty much just a two-man team. They do everything. So a lot of people really don't appreciate what they actually do, and what they do for all of us artists. And that is their hard work is, you know, that's the reason why Illegal is doing what it's doing right now. And then, of course, you have all the artists, myself, Jay Williams, Vince Harder, Tyson Tyler. And then the new Illegal Bandits, which is Brooke, and she's also gonna, you know, offspring and do solo stuff as well this year, I hear, and which is cool because you know, I like to collab with her. She has a killer voice, and I think that she can go really far. And then Brandon, who is a new member of the Illegal Bandits, who started off as a dancer for us, but he's a hip hopper from way back. He's from South Africa. He's a break dancer from South Africa, so he's a hip hopper from way back. He was always spitting and stuff like that on tour. So, you know, we thought, you know, make him into an artist, and then Illegal Bandits came, so it was the perfect opportunity to bring him into the team. And then you got all our dancers. So, you know, when we travel heavy. Like, there's a lot of people. When we went to Homeground, there was a team of like 14 of us. So, you know, it can be quite. You know, there's always good times on tour because there's plenty of people around and everyone loves to party, so it's cool.
So what was wrong with that Marmite sandwich?
Oh, right. It's funny when you check up a status and everyone they hone on in it so bad. Like, everyone's like, what's wrong with Marmite and cheese sandwiches? Like, I'm a fan of Marmite and cheese sandwiches. It was just the way it was constructed. And you know, I've been there.
Was it a bit too thick? Was the cheese thick?
I just don't know what they cut their cheese with, eh? And I looked at the Marmite and I was thinking, spirit, like, you couldn't even, I couldn't even taste the Marmite when I had my one bite. But yeah, and the bread was stale as, but you know, I'm not one to hate, bro. I've been there. I've had the no lunches, you know, so I've been there. So it was just a funny story. And you know, I think that people, you know, the most feedback I get is on those funny stories that I chuck up online. So I'm gonna keep doing it, and you know, hopefully people won't get offended. Or there's been a couple of them there where I've had a few hate mails and stuff like that. But that, it's all fun. It's all in fun. So you know, don't take it too seriously, guys.
All good, bro. We'll round it up. Any last words?
Any last words? I'm lost for words, bro. We've been talking for so long. So long.
Too long, is it?
nah, it's cool. There's been a lot of questions that, you know, I don't usually get asked and stuff like that, so it's been cool. And some, you know, usually on an interview on TV and that, you only have a minute and a half to 2 minutes sort of thing, so it's cool to get a little in-depth look, and it's also good for the fans.
Awesome, bro. We'll have to do it again when your next release comes up.
Yeah, definitely, bro.